Chair in Transgender Studies, your host for those of you who are just joining us. And welcome to our Moving Trans History Forward keynote address with Miss Major. Miss Major is a Black transgender activist who has fought for over 50 years to create a better world for all of us. She is a veteran of the infamous Stonewall Riots, a former sex worker, a survivor of Dannemora prison, and Bellevue Hospital's Queen Tink. Her global legacy of activism is rooted in her own experiences, and she continues to work to uplift transgender women of color, particularly those who have survived incarceration and police brutality. Miss Major is featured in the 2015 documentary film, Major, which you absolutely should see, which explores the life and campaigns of Miss Major Griffin-Gracy. And on the 9th, of January 2021, Miss Major and her partner, Beck Witt, welcomed their son, Isaiah Wittenstein Major, into the world. Now, Miss Major will be in conversation today with Kelendria Nation and Syrus Marcus Ware. Kelendria Nation is a Black woman of trans experience of Caribbean descent who uses her perspective and unique experiences to bring awareness to the various issues surrounding trans people, especially trans women of color. She has dedicated herself to using her voice to impact change and bridge understanding across all communities. She provides advocacy, resolutions, and transitions for trans-identified people. Through her work in community space, through her advocacy, she strives to allow folks to see that because of their multiple intersections, trans, non-binary, and two-spirit identified folks are oftentimes left out of conversations. With collaboration and standing in solidarity with other community members, she has been given the tools of being able to communicate her experience, and this has allowed her to tell her own story in her own voice. It is her hope that in time there will be more opportunities to empower BIMPOC identified people in the same ways that she has been. So welcome, Kelendria.
So privileged and so humbled to be able to join in this conversation with Miss Major and Syrus, and I just want to take time to thank Ms. Major for the resilience and perseverance throughout the years and providing a great example. I am so excited to join in this conversation this morning or this afternoon, wherever you folks are at.
Thank you, Kelendria. Now I'm going to introduce Syrus Marcus Ware, the other person who will be in conversation today. So Syrus Marcus Ware is a Vanier scholar, a visual artist, an activist, a curator, and an educator. Syrus uses drawing, installation, and performance to explore social justice frameworks and Black activist culture. His work has been shown widely in galleries and festivals across Canada. He is part of the Performance Disability Art Collective and a core team member of Black Lives Matter Toronto. He has won several recognitions, including the TD Diversity Award in 2017, the Best Queer Activist Now Magazine Award in 2005, and the Steinott and Ferraro Award in 2012. He is the co-editor of Until We Are Free, Reflections on Black Lives Matter in Canada, published in 2020. In 2017, Syrus was a Chair in Transgender Studies Visiting Fellow, and he gave a talk as part of the Chair's Public Lecture Series. Syrus, welcome. I will now turn it over to Kelendria and Syrus to be in conversation with Miss Major.
Thank you so much, Aaron. We're so looking forward to this discussion. I'm going to let Kelendria ask the first question, and we're, again, so thankful.
Yeah, so let's get started. So we've been working for a future where all trans people get to live long enough to become elders. This is something that is still not guaranteed to so many of us, but it is changing. As a trans elder, what supports do trans elders need right now?
What support? You know, they need lots of support. One of the things that's important is the fact that they are overlooked in meetings and stuff like that, that they go through. And it, you have to accept who they are, what they stand for, what they are part of. And in doing so, then they will continue to live a little bit longer.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
May it be.
Yes.
So we've been talking a lot about abolition. Abolition is on everyone's lips. Now, as one of the people who helped to lead the anti-policing movement from those early days at Stonewall right through to your work today, we're wondering if you could just tell us a little bit of your reflections on what do you think of this recent turn towards abolition? And also, what do you think it will take to have abolition in our lifetime?
Well, you know, that's hard because right now they're really talking about abolition. They are holding meetings and stuff like that. But if we have been struggling and giving reasons to do this years ago, has always been a form of someone standing in line with a sign, fair play, you know, and we don't get it. They don't seem to understand that we exist and have been here since the beginning of time. So one of the reasons that I am involved in this current view of this is because they've got to at least pay attention, acknowledge us, give us some credence as to that we are accepted and that we mean something to them.
Mm-hmm. I would love to hear a little bit more about if you could tell us a little bit about that moment and those moments at Stonewall.
Well, you know, Stonewall was, I guess you could say, a happening that happened. And it started with the police brutality, with them coming in and wishing to put their rules on our bodies. So the girls at that time decided that it was enough. It had been happening for years in the making. So it, I guess it started, you know, with them wanting to shove a girl around. And from there, it went to West Hell. And it continued for 3 days. So it was an interesting time. The sad thing about that is, though, that they did not promote that. They didn't put it in the news. It wasn't important enough to whereby it got attention. So we again got overlooked for the media, you know. So it was a rough time, though. It was rough.
Mm-hmm. You're mentioning erasure. Has that been a common theme that you have noticed? Because now, in comparison, there's so much visibility around specifically trans femme and who we are and what we look like and what we present. You know, how has that changed for you?
You know, it's changed somewhat and it's different by people, not in groups. And that is hard because there are girls who are suffering who aren't in those groups, you know, who aren't around that sort of thing. And that is what really irks me because, say, I've lived this long. It would be nice if another girl lived this long, if I had friends who were my age, someone who's maybe older, you know, but the pressure that they put on people and at the time, it's hard. And when nowadays everybody is talking about, oh, it's wonderful and it makes us a difference, and they're going to try to understand. Well, they don't understand, you know. They haven't walked a mile in our shoes, and that's hard. And until they do, until, you know, they have some sensibility to whereby, say, I don't know, 6 months out of the year, boys have to wear heels, you know, something to where they get it in their head that we have suffered a lot, you know. But until that comes, we don't know what's going to happen.
Thank you.
We've been talking about, and, you know, thank you, Kelendria, for this question around visibility and what, you know, and erasure. And thank you, Ms. Major, for your thoughts. You know, we know that they're in the movements for Black Lives right now, like Black Lives Matter. It's, you know, full of Black trans leadership. You know, there are Black trans leaders, you know, doing this incredible work. But we know that it, you know, being a public trans activist comes with it, you know, a heavy toll. There's like online harassment, there's trolling, there's transphobia. What advice do you have for Black trans leaders who are pushing for change? How do you stay in the fight for the long haul? Because you've been doing this for a long time. How do you stay in the struggle for the long haul?
You don't pay attention to those remarks. You know, if someone says, you know, well, you know, don't pay attention to me. Well, that's good. Don't pay attention to me. I don't care what you do, but you will pay attention. And the thing that they are doing now is that the girls who are involved in this and trying to make a difference, they only let them go so far. You know, they go this to the brink and then they stop it. Until one girl and breaks that mold and goes further than they expecting her to go, will we make it? And right now, we stop all right there, right at the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You mentioned gatekeeping when it comes to particularly the girls, and if folks mm-hmm. don't know, it's trans femme folks or trans femme mm-hmm. identified folks. You know, when we get into nonprofit organizations, for example, or we're working in advocacy work or activist work, you know, mm-hmm. what does that gatekeeping ultimately lead for folks? I know for myself, it can affect my mental health. It can affect my self-awareness in terms of who mm-hmm. I am and how I navigate in the world. What are your thoughts about how that affects the girls in community?
It's simple. How it affects them is very basic. They internalize that. They make it about themselves and they stop. They don't try to go further, you know, than that. The moment someone raises an opposition to them, they step back and figure out what they're doing wrong, you know, and they may not be doing nothing wrong, you know. And we've got to overcome that. We've got to surpass that to whereby we can be the best and the strongest that we possibly can be. You know, it's rough, you know, and when you run into that, you've got to, dare I say, you've got to ignore it. Tell them to mind their fucking business and the rest of you go on.
Mm-hmm. I'm so interested in these, like, these are strategies. These are strategies for survival, and we share these with each other. And, you know, because we don't often have intergenerational conversations where we get to talk, you know, together, we don't always get to share these ideas. And I think, like, yeah, is there anything else you would want to say to trans femmes, to Black trans femmes of color, you know, in terms of how to survive and deal with feelings of powerlessness or what it is to be in this world where, you know, they, you know, we're told don't exist?
you know, is you got to be ready to fight. Plain and simple. You must always be ready to fight, to set yourself down and go for it, because they are going to come at you every way possible. And you must be prepared to put them on their ass if you can, you know. You know, you got to take the blows as it goes, but you get some too. You know, when someone comes to you, bring your ass with you, because it's going to get whipped. Plain and simple.
There's this brilliant Black educator here named Rania El-McGumner, who says, yes, abolition, but you can still catch these hands. And yes, I love that. Right.
Yes. Rania.
I want to kind of expand on what you mentioned about folks, you know, putting up a fight and being aware that the lives mm-hmm. that we lead is going to take a little bit of perseverance on our end, some resilience mm-hmm. on our end. But what advice would you give particularly trans folks of color who are dealing with the feelings of not belonging and having no power, even when they make their voice heard, because of the lack of support systems and housing security and employment? I know here in British Columbia, where I'm located, we're in the middle of a housing crisis. So affordable housing is very hard to find. And with so many trans-identified folks, particularly folks of color and gender diverse folks, you know, having employment or being able to sustain long-term employment is very difficult. And so can you give any folks examples in your life that has helped you to persevere and overcome specific obstacles that you have had to encounter?
Gosh, to my life. Well, years ago, a friend of mine that died by the name of Puppy. And she was very important to me personally at that time. She was in an apartment that was locked, and she had two dogs with her. They found her in the tub, killed, with the dogs sitting there waiting. They were very vicious, and so whoever killed her was someone she knew. And no one, the police didn't look for them. They didn't look for it. And so the girls and I decided that we would pay attention to what we were doing. And you got to really pay attention to your voice. You must listen to you. No matter what they tell you and no matter how it goes, your voice matters. And in that sense, it was one of those things whereby in the way that it went, it was important that they did this, you know. So you got to pay attention to your voice, no matter what it is you are getting, what you receive, what you think you do from other people. They don't necessarily know what you've gone through, what you've been through, who you are, what basis started you on this journey. So when you do that, you got to take the time to listen to your own voice. That is so important to do that, because then can nobody tell you no?
Thank you.
So we're getting to hear the beautiful, wonderful sounds of your child, which is so lovely. I don't know if you saw my child just popped in here.
Yeah, I saw
something very important she had seen on YouTube. But so, you know, as a parent, you know, as a parent to parent, for a lot of us trans parents, we've been looking for role models. You know, there are not a lot of examples of trans parents in the public eye. You know, if you wanted to sort of reach out to the trans parents who are watching, what would you want to sort of say to the fellow trans parents who are watching from around the world?
Oh, to love them and to watch them and to care for them and to look out for them and prepare your life as their life. You can live your life and go on from there. They're all you mean, everything to you.
It's amazing to be a parent. I'm so thankful. I wonder also if you wanted to say something to parents of trans kids, conversely, so all the parents who are watching who have trans kids at home, is there any advice or tips you'd want to give to parents of trans children?
You know, I would just say, you know, there's a love them. That is the most important thing you can do. Love them and tell them the truth. Don't, I'm a woman or whatever have you. You know, tell them the truth and let them sort it out. And when they do, they'll be with you. I have another child who is 20, 40 years old, who's mine. So they care about you. They will love you, you know, no matter what you are and where you come from. Right?
Thank you. Right. Thank you.
I just kind of want to expand on this idea of parenthood and how so many of us are lacking support systems or even have someone that we can turn to. I know mentorship is a huge thing in the States. You know, a lot of Black femme folks, you know, have gay children. In Canada, what I have experienced and seen, it's not the same. You know, it's very hard for folks to make connections. You know, whether we come from broken homes or we have parents who we feel, you know, don't prepare us for life. I know in my experience, many parents do not prepare trans and gender diverse identified children in the same way that they prepare cis children. And so oftentimes we're having to play catch up with our peers, you know, this sense of competition for jobs within the right to survive. And so for me, this kind of ties in with feminism, you know, having the agency and having an awareness, of the rights that women have in society, and particularly trans women. And so oftentimes, you know, trans rights are pitted against feminism as a way to separate us trans femmes from the rest of society. And so what does trans inclusive feminism mean to you? And then secondly, how would you challenge those TERFs, trans exclusionary radical feminists, who say that trans women experience male privilege?
That's quite a lot. Well, first I would tell you, you know, when you run into women who feel like a trans person should not be involved there, ask her, you know, simply to leave the space you're in and go somewhere else and take that bullshit with her, you know, because as women, we are entitled to what women get. Now, women don't get what they're supposed to get because they should be receiving the same thing as a man, you know. And if they're going to treat us like we don't deserve it, well then give me the stuff you would give a man. And I'm a woman, that simple. And, you know, I tend to have a tendency to simply go where places I'm not wanted. And what happens is they take it in question, you know. They wonder, well, why am I here? What am I doing? What am I up to? Why am I doing this? And those are questions that they have to answer, not me. And so I put them in that spot and leave them there, because where I belong, I belong. when I go, I need to go, you know. And they take it from there, you know. They don't give us the credence to understand that we have thought about it and we earned the rights to be there. And whatever form that takes, whatever guise that is how it is, period. Yeah.
Beautiful. I wonder if we could talk a little bit about, you've been involved in organizing and activism, you know, for decades on so many different issues, including prisoners' justice, but also around sex workers' rights and sex worker activism. I'm wondering if we could talk a little bit about sex worker justice and, you know, to, you know, all of the there are so many of us who engage or who do this as a job. And, you know, we know that there's still a lot of stigma. There's not a lot of safe working conditions. We don't have, you know, all of the things that would make this a little bit of a better situation. What are you seeing happening right now in sex worker activism? And what would you want to say to all the trans sex workers out there who are watching?
Well, first of all, it's getting better. A little bit. And you have to think of why you're involved in this. Is you're in it for fun? You're in it for profit? You're in it to make money? Or you're in it because you have to do it to survive, you know? And regardless of what your reason is, that is a viable source of income, you know? It's not a lot of stuff going around that we have available to us, you know? And so if you're out there and you're doing this, do it safely. Do it and you're aware of what it is, you know, and keep yourself safe and then enjoy it, you know. If you run into, say, a John who doesn't treat you right, well, that's simple. Don't go there, you know. Treat yourself like you deserve it, you know. It's so hard to put yourself in a position to whereby you suffer and you become a victim to the situation, but you don't have to, you know. And if you do it that way, you'll come out the other end. If you decide to come out, if I could, I would serve another trick. because I figure, you know, you can pick and choose it, you know. If he's cute enough, I'm going with him.
I know for myself, when I was in sex work, I did street-based sex work. It was a way for me to gain autonomy. As we know, so many trans femme folks or gender diverse folks want to find a way out of sex work eventually. You know, they're not enjoying themselves anymore, or they want to enter a different career path. You know, what are some tips that you would give folks who are wanting to make that transition, if we can say, in their lives from sex work to maybe a 9-to-5 or maybe starting their own business? What are some tips that you can give folks in terms of turning a new leaf in their life, per se?
Yeah. Well, you know, if you do want to change jobs, you have to consider the job, write down what the details are, and then as you're turning the tricks and hustling, you must constantly do that on the side. And slowly but surely, it'll build up. This will go down, build up, and then it'll stop. And then it'll stop, you know. But, you know, there's a way to do them both, you know. You can do both of them, and it'll take the pressure off of you, you know, because pressure comes from all sorts of people, you know. And when you get to the point of you're doing your job and you're hustling somewhat, you know, you'll find a way to relax, a way to go about it, you know. So that's the best way to go about it, you know. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
So of course, the theme of this conference is moving trans history forward, and it is, you know, hosted, you know, and if we were gathering in person, we'd be able to go into the archives and look at the past. We could, you know, do a lot. I wanted to ask, we wanted to ask you this question about, so bear, it's a bit of a sci-fi question. Imagine, Miss Major, that you could travel through time and go back to any moment in your activist history and relive it. What's the moment you would want to go back to that you would want to experience again?
Oh God, backwards.
Yeah, you could also go forward. Is there a moment in the future you want to
Let's don't go back. Let's go forward. Going forward, I would like to be in a world whereby people would accept it on their face value. And that's it, you know, to have the freedom to work if we choose, to hustle if we choose, to be able to have it and maintain your sense of self. You know, I would want to go to a future that would be open to everybody. And I mean everybody, you know, trans, non-trans, people in general. And that would be a wonder to be in a place to whereby trans was accepted. Yeah.
Can I ask you the same question, Kelendria? If you could go to your ideal future, what would it look like?
Oh, wow. That's actually a really great question. You know, it's not really known about me, but I love Victorian times and the 50s and the 40s and, you know, the glam and the just the whole aesthetic. You know, I personally would want to exist in the 40s and in the 50s and, you know, really setting a tone for the girls to come. You know, I think what's missing for me personally in my own gender affirmation process is real life examples. I know we have such amazing folks like Janet Mock in the States and Laverne Cox, but here in Canada, we don't really have much visibility. And I would love for, you know, a trans femme of color or a trans person in general, you know, to be able to get to a level where they can provide mentorship for folks. You know, in my own advocacy work, I always think about how I can bring other folks along and be participatory, because this process to me is not autonomous. Like, I didn't get here alone. You know, I have so many folks who have helped me and help uplift me throughout my lives and really help make me visible. And I think that's so important. I think folks being able to be visible in the spaces that they are really saves lives. You know, so many of us, you know, struggle with mental health conditions and, you know, loneliness. I know for myself as a trans femme, that's something that ebbs and flows, what it means to be lonely. I don't know for you, Miss Major, like if that's something you can answer, like how would you give advice to folks who may feel lonely? You know, they've come to a certain point in their transition or their gender affirmation process. And, you know, on paper, you know, everything is checked off. But, you know, how do folks deal, particularly now with COVID, with this sense of loneliness and wanting to connect?
You know, one of the things that is neat about this time is the fact that we have Zoom around, and there are people that you can talk to, and it's important that you do talk. You share your experiences, even if it's just a friend, you know, someone who you can identify with, someone who you can believe in and listen to. That will get them through it, you know, because there are doctors online and stuff like that. But there are a lot of doctors who believe in us, who will say, well, what you're doing is a good thing, you know. So find your friends, talk to them, step out of your box and into theirs. Yeah.
I love that. And I think that we're, you know, building these communities online, mm-hmm. and building these communities in our home cities and starting to try to articulate what that could look like. And I'm so, I'm so interested in, you know, how we build these kind of, if we're working towards that future that you just said, Miss Major, where trans people are free, where we have what we need to thrive. You know, if we get to live our 40s glam dreams that Kelendria was talking about, if we get to, you know, live my sci-fi speculative fantasy dream, you know, how do we get to that kind of future that we're sort of aiming towards? You know, this year has been a year of a lot of change. We saw, you know, lots of people in the streets last summer, you know, calling for an end to police brutality, calling for, you know, we heard about abolition and abolishing the system that would allow the kinds of things like, you know, the killing of Breonna Taylor and like these other things, you know. So, you know, I'm thinking that probably this summer is going to be a spicy summer as well. It's going to be heated. We're going to be out there, you know, for folks who are sort of moving and leaning in and thinking about the future. I'm just wondering if you have, you know, are there ways that, or people that you read or that shows that you watch or movies that you watch that help you to kind of imagine and think about the future and know what to do to go forward?
Shows that I watch. I watch old shows and TCM and stuff like that. And I take what they're showing and put my spin on it as I watch it, you know. Different things like Mommy Dearest and stuff like that, you know. I look at that stuff and try to make it trans identified, you know, make her me and what I would do at that time. And that works for me, you know. It depends upon what you want, you know, because each of us and everybody is different. You know, and someone can look at something, the same thing I watch, and see something entirely different than I do, you know. So I would want it to be open to interpretation, you know. Take and make it whatever it is you need to make you go through it and come out of the end.
Well, you were a subject of a film. You were the subject of something that we all got to watch and take in and interpret as ourselves. What was the experience like being the subject of a film? What was it like when they were filming Major?
You know, it was very normal and they were unobtrusive to me in regards to the movie. And it ended and it began very casually, you know, and I thought very highly of the people that produced it, because a panel was gotten of different people in that life, and they decided with the producers what was to be seen. So it was a good experience. Now, it's not something I would do on a regular basis, no. But then it was important and it had to get out there, you know, because I need the girls to realize that somebody does care about them, somebody older, someone who has lived their life, who knows what they're going through. And I wanted them to understand that I care about them all, you know, whether I've seen them or I know them or not, you know. I want them to succeed in whatever form of that they need to express it, you know. So it was a good time. It was good. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I think that film is like foundational work for all of us to get a glimpse of, you know, where we come from and where we've been and what is possible for us. I saw your film as a possibility story. You know, it is possible to go through and survive what we've been through. You know, so many of us have trauma that we deal with on a regular basis. And I'm going to give this question to Syrus as well. You know, besides watching television and the folks that are close to you, you know, what is some skill building work when you have to deal with the trauma that we exist with and in daily basis?
What you have to do is keep that stuff to yourself and then slowly dissipate it. You know, like you take a paste when you're cooking and you spread it around and you watch it boil up to where it disappears and it's good, you know? So break it down. Don't take that stuff on personally. You know, do your best to break it up, slowly do what you do and get it to evaporate and disappear because you don't need that. There's enough stuff out here that you do have to deal with and you can, but you have to get rid of all the little stuff, every bit of it. What do you think?
Yeah, and I spend a lot of time sort of thinking through, I do therapy and I do things like that as I'm a med person. And so I have support. And one of the things that they sort of tell you is that the only way through is through. And I think it is that it's like breaking it down into small manageable chunks and then figuring out, okay, how am I gonna, you know, how do I deal with this little piece here? And how do I deal with that piece and how do they connect? And, you know, I'm so thankful that we get to be in a moment now where we can talk about our mental health, where we can talk about our experiences and we can talk about it a bit more openly. You know, we don't have to necessarily, with shame sort of hide away our experiences when we're down or if we have an experience of trauma or if we can talk about it now in a more open way. And I'm very thankful for that, for sure. I have a question for both of you, and it's, you know, as a trans man, as a trans masculine person, who obviously has got my femme side too, but, you know, I'm wondering, you know, one of the things that I think a lot about in our communities is, you know, how we support each other. And I'm just wondering, you know, this is maybe like a 2.0 conversation, maybe a conversation that we would normally have within, you know, sort of a family group here. But I'm just wondering what ways you're sort of seeing us moving forward into the future and how in our trans communities, we can be supporting each other. You know, how can trans mass folks better support y'all? And how can we, you know, sort of show up for each other in better ways? And how can we take care of each other? In ways that we need to going forward?
Well, the first thing you can do is share your experiences. Let them know what it is like from what your perspective is, to open up, to share every part of you is a story. And so you share all of them, you know. Now, some may be more personal or more involved. So you don't share those, but you do share something. You share, you know, one of the things I used to do is start a group off with girls saying what they did to where did the name come from? You know, what was the thing that got you to pick your name that you chose? Well, bingo, you got stories. Yeah. What about you?
I think for me, this is kind of like a two-prong approach that I think in my life. I think mm-hmm. there are some essentials that we need as trans folks. We need support systems. We need allies. I think allies are so important. People mm-hmm. who are committed to being present and speaking up for us in the spaces that we don't have access to. Like you mentioned, Ms. Major, I think it's so important to have people who have privilege, whether it's white privilege, whether it's privilege from their jobs, to really bring trans folks into the conversation. Mm-hmm. And then on the other side, I know for myself, like chosen family is so important. You know, for me, it's all about creating space for yourself, putting mm-hmm. yourself out there, as you mentioned, Ms. Major. You know, I know for me, I'm an introvert, which people don't really believe me when I say, but you know, being in community for me is affirming because it allows me to give back. But I also have so much chosen family who hold me up and support me and really help me do that work in terms of overcoming the stuff that we deal with. I know in my advocacy work, I always mention it's not transition that is difficult for a lot of folks. It's the shit that we deal with on a consistent basis. You know, for me, this is about having services that are catered to us, you know, us being represented in every single aspect and us being included in terms of how services are tailored to us. And I can go on and on. but I honestly think we have to have a little bit of agency and advocacy for ourselves as trans folks. You know, systems are built to support us, but I also think, you know, we have to know who we are and where we're going and the type of care and services and life that we want to lead. You know, as you mentioned, Ms. Major, this life isn't for everyone, and I say the same thing, you know, but it is one of the best decisions I made for myself, and that decision is for myself only.
Just something that when you were talking, Kelendria, it made me think of that quote that you said, Miss Major, that there's this umbrella LGBT, but there's a hole in it and the girls are getting wet, you know? Mm-hmm. And I just think like, yeah, you know, Kelendria, what you're talking about, this need for, you know, what are the other letters doing to sort of patch those holes in the umbrella and make sure that the girls aren't getting wet? And I'm just so, I want us to keep always thinking about that, about what are the ways that transmasculine folks are supporting trans femmes and non-binary folks? You know, what are the ways that cis folks are supporting all trans folks? What are the ways that we can, you know, just be doing a better job at taking care of each other? So thank you both so much for dreaming into that.
I think as we get ready to move into the closing of our discussion, I think that, moving forward, we hope to see more trans, non-binary, and two-spirit identified folks of color in leadership and positions of influence. In community spaces or community building, excuse me, there has been some commitment to bringing folks along with us as we move into career paths or try to mobilize and advocacy work and activism. How do you specifically bring folks along with you through your work? And then what principles of leadership have been successful for you when engaging with community members?
Well, you know, what is important that is that you teach someone what you know, that it doesn't end with you. And so it's, if I'm running an organization, the person who is with me is with me, and they take on a lot of the responsibility of it. I oversee it, but they take over most of the responsibility. It's hard to teach someone if they don't want to learn. So what you do is you search and you look and you constantly until you find that one person that wants to learn. And you teach them and you tell them to teach somebody else. That's how it goes on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What about you, Syrus? You're really, really busy and do a lot of work yourself. You know, how does this land for you? How does the question land for you? As well.
Yeah, I mean, I've always thought that, you know, any of the work that I've ever done has been about making sure that the doors stay propped open, you know, or that we tear down the doors so that there are no doors, you know, tear down the doors. So all of the things that I've ever tried to do has always been about how to break things open and make more space. I want us to be freer. So to me, like, you know, the kinds of things, I mean, I often work in leadership roles, and it's always been about, you know, making sure that there is a representation and visibility of Black trans disabled people, in my case, you know, to make sure that we're there, that we're present, we're visible, you know, to make sure that we're always making, carving out space for other folks to be able to come and be in the space. So, you know, I think a lot of it is trying to change the structures, and then the rooms that you do get access to, how do you change those rooms so that they're no longer these exclusive spaces? So I think it's really important to make sure that, you know, we're making room for all of these voices. We have so much brilliance in our communities, so much creativity, so much magic coming out of trans communities. Like, there should be trans leadership in all of the organizations, you know, in this country, right? There should be trans leadership, you know, at all levels of government. There should be trans leadership everywhere because, you know, we are, you know, doing the work. We stayed doing the work. And so I'm really interested in what are the ways that we can make sure that we get trans folks in these positions of decision making, and so I'm very interested in that. So yeah, thanks for that question, Kelendria. Yeah, so we have probably time for one more question here with us before we open it up for everybody else. And I wonder if we could just sort of say, you know, we're going here into 2021. It has been quite the last year and a half, you know, we've experienced unprecedented things, you know, both with this pandemic and then, of course, with all those police killings last summer, the Black Lives Matter movement, you know, really kicking off, you know, even more, and, you know, all of this revolutionary action that's happening. As we head into 2021, what are your hopes for this year? I'll ask both of you. For trans people, for all of us, what are your hopes?
Well, my hope is that we calm down enough to whereby we talk to one another so that we find out where this hatred has come from, you know, and in discussing this, we slowly get it to disappear, you know, that would be a major accomplishment in this country and the world.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you, Kelendria. Can I ask you the same?
Yeah, I think for me, I always put the emphasis on community. You know, community saves lives. I think that it's important for us to come together more. I mean, we have opportunities like this conference. We have opportunities where other events happen in community, but to really build networks of support and family for each other. I think particularly here in Canada, it doesn't look the same as it does in the United States. And I think that for us is really something that we can work on here in Canada and specifically, you know, I know for myself, you know, coming together and putting myself out there as someone who's very introverted has been, you know, something that I really took seriously. And in terms of the pandemic and, you know, how things were happening last year, you know, it was for me, a very dark place. And sometimes, you know, it's so important to have folks that you're able to reach out to who understand our perspective in our lives. I think, you know, what my dream is for community as a whole is to really have more trans femmes representation of color in all organizations. You know, for myself, I'm often the only one, or, you know, there's one of a few of us, and, you know, I really want folks to empower trans femme folks of color to do the work and to pay us equitably and to not just talk about intersectionality, but be about it. And to, if you have power, it is your responsibility to bring folks in. That it's not something that you can say, and it's not something you can talk about, and it's not something that's really off the side of your desk. Be about it. And I'm expecting you to be about it.
Oh, may it be. I hope. This year could, you know, may this year be the year that Black trans lives matter. You know, may this year be the year that we really start to see the change. You know, the changes that were begun, you know, that were begun by you, Miss Major, you know, the changes that got us down this road, that we continue, you know, in your footsteps, and we continue to work shoulder to shoulder with you in this fight for trans justice, for Black justice, for, you know, abolition, for, you know, for a freer world where we're all going to get a chance to make it, where we can sit in the grass with our kids, where we can, you know, sit with the girls, where we can hang out, where we can be together and not be, you know, experiencing all of the kinds of violences that we have experienced and that we often continue to experience. Things are changing, and I'm so thankful for your labor and for your work and your organizing, and Kelendria, you know, you and I have just, you know, getting a chance to meet and getting a chance to hear about your work in the West Coast, and it's so important to have your presence and visibility in Vancouver. So just to both of you, I'm so thankful to be in the struggle with you. And I'm thankful for this, the chance to have had a chance to chat today. Thank you.
thank you, Syrus. You have been so gracious throughout this entire process. And the organizer, Aaron and Michael, and you too, Miss Major, I wish I could give you a hug in person if that was ever possible. And thank you for all the work and representation you've done. You know, folks like you save lives. And I just want to say that you really do save lives. And it's such an honor to be able to be in conversation with you. And you know, hopefully as we move forward in this year, forward in terms of being able to open up in terms of how we are able to socialize as people, that again, we bring trans masculine, trans feminine folks along with us and, you know, involve each other in the chain. So again, I'm so thankful. This has been a really warming and really spirit changing for me. So thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I am so excited to be able to work with both of you. It's done me a lot of good to hear this. So thank you both.
Thank you, Ms. Major. Thank you. We want to say a huge shout out and thank you to all of you who have been putting your questions into the Q&A chat. So thanks for folks who have put questions into the Q&A, and welcome back, Aaron, to the screen. Thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for all of your work at the archives, and thank you for making this conference happen. We've talked today with Miss Major about the past, about the future, about everything in between in this moment of moving trans history forward. So thank you.
Thank you, everybody. This has been a great conversation, and it's not over yet. So I really appreciate listening to the three of you talk together. And now I'm going to bring forward some questions from the audience who have been watching and listening. So most of them are directed, of course, to you, Ms. Major. A few of them will bring in Syrus and Kelendria as well. So first question is also one of my questions. Ms. Major, you're someone that many, many people look up to all over the world and use as a role model and an inspiration. And the question for you is, who have been your role models and your inspirations?
Oh, God, you know, it changes with the time. Back when I was young, it was Puppy. Today is somebody else. But today, I believe in Dannemora. She has done a lot of stuff that was puts the girls up in the involved in stuff. She's very unique and talented,
and she's very contemporary and a lot younger than you. I'm asking, who went before you that inspired you when you were young?
A girl by the name of Puppy.
Puppy,
and okay. She died. But because of her, I got involved in this work that I do now.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Another question from the audience. So after so many years of fighting and struggling for trans rights, you've continued to allow love to guide you. How do you continue to move forward with such positivity and grace in the face of so much injustice?
You know, you've got to love them. You can't go along this world and hate, you know. It doesn't solve anything. And through love, everybody can understand what you feel. and they'll accept that and move forward.
It's a wonderful message, and it's wonderful hearing it from someone with all the history that you have. We've had some we had an elders panel yesterday, and most of the elders were saying a similar kind of thing. You know, at some point you just have to have faith in others and care for them, and they'll come with you. A question for all the speakers. So what are some of the most affirming trans spaces that you have been to in person or online?
Oh, come now. You girls must be said something.
That's everybody. It's not just Miss Major. So Syrus and Kelendria, they're asking you too.
I'm unsure, and that's not because I haven't experienced it. I think for me, I really have high expectation about the spaces I enter to. I think for me, what makes me feel safer, because I don't believe spaces can be safe. What makes me feel safer is if they prioritize the voices of trans folks of color, indigenous folks, perspective of folks who are marginalized in our society. You know, I feel that sometimes community can be overwhelmingly white, and I want to see more folks of color get involved and have opportunities to involve. You know, lived experience is so important. You know, people are asking, you know, in organizations for lived experience, and lived experience has to be remunerated properly. And lived experience counts, and lived experience is experience itself. And I think that, you know, for folks to have an assumption that spaces are always welcoming, or there has been spaces that have always been affirming, I think I would counter and say that spaces are works in progress, and that I think it's a community responsibility to really bring forth the principles of how to make safe spaces safer.
Could you say the question one more time, Erin?
So what kind of spaces have you been in that you felt are the most trans-affirming, that are either in-person spaces or online spaces?
I have to, say I've been, you know, in trans communities in Toronto, since 2000. I came out in 2000, and there have been a couple of spaces that have been really beautiful. And one of those spaces is Blockarama, and it's this big Black queer and trans party that is a community center gathering, a homecoming, an arts festival all at once. It happens at Pride and has, you know, 11,000 Black queer and trans people dancing together. There's a community information hub with booths and community supports. There's trans people in leadership in the Blockarama team, and it is a space that, you know, has had trans people hosting the stage, Atik Milan and Kayandora show, and, you know, all of these, and Kim Nkuru, and, you know, all of these incredible folks. And it's been a place that has really felt like home. And, I'm really thankful for spaces like that. We need more spaces, basically. What we need is more spaces that are year round, where we can feel at home. And I think, like, Niall Banji wrote that article in TSQ the Trans Studies Reader about homing desires, and about this idea of homecoming in trans communities, and how for a lot of trans people of color, we don't often feel at home in trans communities. So not only do we need more trans affirming spaces, but we need more trans affirming spaces that are intersectional. You know, where as disabled and mad trans people, we feel welcome. Whereas Black trans people, we feel welcome. Whereas queer, you know, and other, you know, just all of the ways that we get to experience difference, where those parts are part of our trans experience too. So we need more of that.
Thank you. Miss Major, do you want to weigh in on this question?
No, thank you.
Okay, so the next one is directly for you. And the question is, what organizing tactics did you engage in back in the day? Have any of them petered out in these times in trans activist circles? What would you like to see reemerge of any of the older tactics that may have vanished? So, you know, what worked back then that maybe isn't happening now that you think should be happening now?
I think one of the things that did work was being prepared to fight for what it is we stand for. And I should to believe that if that came back, it would help. Because right now, they don't know what they're standing for. They don't know what they're fighting for. So if that came back, it would be a marvelous thing.
Okay, thank you. There's a bunch of questions here that are all very similar. And they're basically, I can distill them down to what can white folks do to support the issues of Black trans folks and Black trans femmes in particular. So what have you got to say for the white people in the audience who want to know how to be good allies?
Well, you know, first of all, they could listen to us. They could stop thinking that we don't know what we're talking about. They feel that if, well, she's talking out of her hat. Well, that hat I wear. So since I wear it, listen to me. Pay attention to me. I'm sorry. You know, they don't give us the attention that we need. And if they do, then they don't believe it. So if they listen to us, then we can lead.
Syrus, Kelendria, do you want to add anything to that?
I would just add to say, we know that we need more leadership by trans people of color. So if you're in a leadership situation and you're not a trans person of color, what is your succession plan look like? What does it look like to make sure that in the future there is a trans person of color in that role, you know, and thinking about, you know, what are you doing in the day-to-day to support trans leadership, to make sure that there's a profile and platform and space and funding for trans people of color in your communities to be able to have their brilliance shared as much as yours is, you know, because we know that white folks are, as Ms. Major said, going to be listened to always, right? And that we are not always listened to. So what are you doing to change those conditions to make sure that we're being listened to, that we're being heard, as Kelendria has said, being remunerated for our work and for our experiences, you know, and what are you doing in support of that? You know, right now we're looking for action. People are looking for not statements or talk, but action.
Kelendria, anything to add?
Yeah, and thinking about action, you know, inviting us in the door and giving us a position once we're in an organization is great, you know, but allowing us to grow in those positions. You know, oftentimes folks of color are in grassroots positions. They're not able to grow. And, you know, this expectation that we should be grateful to be in these spaces, I think white folks really have to think about long term. How are you supporting folks of color, particularly trans femme of color? Are we able to grow in these positions that we're being invited into and in these spaces? You know, are we able to be not only survive but thrive in our lives? It's so important, you know, with everything that's going on, lack of housing, COVID, lack of support systems, you know, having security when it comes to our work and our jobs is so affirming, and it's so powerful for folks, and it leads folks to be able to have a chance to grow into themselves, and it saves people's lives. And I think white folks can talk about allyship all they want. I want to see how you are demonstrating allyship. I think for me in my own life, I have a wonderful mentor and friend, Nikki Zawatsky, who I feel has done such a wonderful job of not only demonstrating what this means, but really being about it. And there's not a lot of people in community who are like them. And I wouldn't be able to sit here as a trans femme of color and have language and be able to speak without the support, and also the support of my chosen family. And I think when we're talking about how allyship is going to be demonstrated and how white folks need to participate in this work, just do the work. It's not about being perfect. It's not about not making mistakes. Do the work. Folks of color will tell you when you're making a mistake. I know I will. And so, you know, to really, really make it about your life work, not about just the hat you wear when you're in community.
Thank you both. Thank you, all three of you. Okay, slightly different direction. Simple question, but maybe a longer answer. I don't know. Miss Major, are you planning on writing an autobiography?
No.
All right. Well, we got that out of the way. I thought that would probably be a quick one. Okay. So what is your advice for youth or even older transgender and non-conforming folks who are facing the feeling of isolation or the lack of sense of family when first entering the community? And especially during this time of COVID, but it's longer than just COVID. So sure. People figure out they're trans, they enter the community and they feel isolated. So what's your advice to them?
Well, when you just start to realize that you are trans, you have to sort out where to go to find other trans people, because it's hard to start something and feel as if you're alone, and then take that and then expand it, decide to go to other groups, through other meetings, to other people, and then you will find that you sort out and figure out where you stand in it, and that will keep you from feeling isolated and alone.
Thank you. So more advice being asked here. Person who asked this question says, I'd like to hear more of your thoughts on how to support trans kids at this time. And the person who's asking the question says they have a daughter, age 15, who is stressed and hurt by current online conversations about trans people, especially about trans girls and women. And so this is a parent who's asking, how can I help her? How do you work with families where trans family members and cis family members have really different emotional awareness? So one parent is supportive, one parent is not. So how do we support kids in that in those kinds of situations, especially trans femme kids?
Oh, God. Well, first of all, the parent who is involved with the child, they should talk to them, get them to open up to them. And a parent who isn't, leave stuff around that they can read, because after they read the stuff, they will understand what the child's going through. It is not easy deciding to be that you're transgender, period, no matter what you are, boy or girl. It's hard to imagine that you have a life that can result in a child, a family, other things like that. They don't think that they do, and then go with them to certain events, not all the events, but certain events, so that they can understand that they have a life, they have a community, and they can be a part of it.
If I may add, it also really helps to have be exposed to people like yourselves, so that they can see that there is a future, that there is a life for them. And so,
obviously.
Yeah, for being there. Syrus, you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, just to say, my twin is an incredible support to me as a trans person, but she's also the mother to a trans kid. So she has my nephew, who's now 11, and who started his transition at 5. And I think that what I've learned through watching her is, as Miss Major says, read as much as you can read. My twin used to go to the Philly Trans Wellness Conference because she lived near there, and she would be the first person at 8 a.m. in those 8 a.m. sessions. If you ever wondered who goes to the 8 a.m. sessions, it's eager moms who are like trying to be the best for their kids, and she'd be in the front row and take notes and, get as much information as you can. But the most important thing that you can do is to just keep telling your kid every single day that you love them. That you love them, that you're going to fight for them, that you're there for them. If one parent isn't maybe as on board, or maybe there's a cis family member who isn't as on board, your role is even more important to say, forget, I'm going to be a bit of a wall here between you and that person. I love you. I want you, I expect you, I care for you. And just to be, you know, to be that champion for that person, because it will make a huge difference for them to know that they've got that one person in their corner, and that, you know, that it's, you know, if it's their mom or their sibling or whoever it is, to have that one person in their corner is going to make a huge difference. And then figuring out what kind of supports are around in your town or in your neighborhood, you know, for trans youth, because there are some incredible trans youth support groups. There's also online supports for parents of trans kids. My twin is in a couple of Facebook groups that are for parents of trans kids, and you know, they're doing incredible support for each other, and they cheer each other on when their kids are having, you know, surgeries or whatever they have, and it's a really beautiful community. So you know, your role is going to be really key here, and I think that your child is going to be really lucky to have you in their corner. So go out there, give them the biggest hug that you can, and tell them that you're going to be there fighting, you know, and rooting for them all the way through. It makes a huge difference. Now, my nephew is 11, so he's a classic preteen. So he's like, I'm not going to any groups. I'm not going to go. Like, he just wants to play gaming in his room on his game thing. So that's what he's doing. But there are great groups for trans youth that if you can get them to get out of their Game Boys, they might really enjoy. So anyways, good luck with everything.
Thank you. Good advice. And you know, there's starting to be some research that shows exactly what you said is also borne out in the research as well. So personal experience, we had some elders talking, and one of the questions that I asked them about was the experience of shame, because a lot of folks who came up in earlier years went through that. And a couple of them said, well, my family always supported me. I never felt shame. Right. And these are folks who, you know, are one of them is over 80 now. And he said he never felt shame in his life. That was Jude Patton, because his family loved him all the way through. So there's another personal experience of this, the same thing, even in much darker times. Can change the subject. Question for you, Miss Major. Can you tell us more about your work with incarcerated and formerly incarcerated trans folks? And what can the average trans person do to support this kind of work?
Well, to support the work, you must get involved with an agency that deals with them in prison, because you start with working with them in the prison system to get them out of there. And for me, in dealing with them, is when they come home, that's the time to really pay attention to what they've gone through and who they are. And you have to really get involved in their lives and help them to acclimate to the society that exists now, because more than likely, it isn't the same thing, you know. Things have progressed much out here, whereas it didn't, it stayed the same in the prison system. So in doing that and working with them, you you find out who they are. You get to enjoy them. You get them to step out of their box and into the world. And that way, you feel good about it. You feel, I feel, when I do it, elated and good, happy. Yeah.
Thank you. Different direction again. Miss Major, why did you choose the name Miss Major?
that is my birth given name. I've been Barbara Valerie, many names, 100 names. And the last time I went to prison, I came out and I was just sick of women being, oh, that's me. So what I did was I took my first name, and that was it, Major Griffin-Gracy. So that's how I got Major.
Okay. So your first name was Major and you just put Miss in front of it.
That's it.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, little personal anecdotes are actually really nice to know. Thank you. Okay, so another question. In some of the elders panel's discussions about binary and in the elders panel, which we had yesterday, discussions about binary and non-binary folks came up, and some of the elders said that they identify as non-binary. So how can we make space for elders to voice their changing identities as more language is becoming available if they want to make use of it? So, you know, we got these folks who came out at a time where non-binary wasn't a possibility. Yeah. And are you seeing that happening, and how do we make space for that to happen?
It's happening a lot, but what I find, especially since I'm older, is that you get them to talk to you, you know, because then you'll find out exactly what it is. This non-binary and quad binary and four person binary, I don't know what all that stuff is, but I'm me and they're them. So I get them to tell me what it is, and if it's binary, whatever it is, you know, give them the love and respect of what they decide to do with their self. You know, that is the most important thing you can do with them.
So I'm going to follow up on that a little bit for my own questions. Is you know, if you came out and you found yourself as trans before the year 2000, everybody was, all we had really available was men and women. We didn't have all these other options that have come into being since then. Do you think that there's a lot of folks who came out in those earlier years, going all the way back, who, if they had these options, or now that they have these options, are more interested in them? Because I think people were forced to kind of choose an either or in a time when maybe they would have liked to be a both and.
You know, it's true, because I came out in the 50s. And so there was no such thing as what I was choosing to be. I think if they would have had the choice or the words, acknowledgement of that, they would have chosen that, you know, because male and female is tough, you know. It's hard to be a female person and a male person is separated. And this way, there's more give and take in it, you know. There's more of an opportunity to be who you see you are and relax in that. Yes, they would have definitely chosen something different than it did.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to shift gears again. So what would you consider to be one of the best moments of activist victory for you? A moment where you and the girls really kick some ass? That's how they asked it. I'm just repeating it.
Yeah. 69, because we stood up for ourselves, and that was important. It's the shame of it is that it did nothing to change the attitude of the straight world, you know. They still felt as if we were an abomination to the rest of the world, you know. But we did stand up, we did make a difference, and it's still going on, you know, the fight continues. So always be prepared to put new gloves and fight.
It doesn't go away, does it?
No, it doesn't. No.
Okay, we're coming close to the end here. Mm-hmm. And so again, a little different angle. Question for each of the panelists. What is one thing that you wish you'd known in the first year of your transition?
Oh, I'm out.
Is it too long ago?
Oh, Lord, I can't remember.
I get it. I mean, we'll come back to you and I'll ask you, what do you think people should know in the first year of their transition? But let's see what Syrus and Kelendria have to say first.
One thing I wish I knew, I guess I wish I knew that it was about to be to get so much better. You know, I wish that all of the things that seemed insurmountable at the time, you know, I was trying to get access to hormones and surgery and things like that, that for me was something that I wanted. And I was just getting no's all across the board, because I wanted to do it in my way. I wanted to do it on my terms, and I was not willing to play the binary game. And so I was getting a lot of no's, but I think I wish I knew that it was going to, that if I just kept going, it was about to be so much better. And that it is in fact possible to define for yourself what man is, what any of these gender identities are. You know, we get to define for ourselves what they are. So I wish I had known that there things were a lot freer than I was being told by the trans folks I met at that time.
Okay. Kelendria.
For myself, there's a lot. Men don't affirm you. Looks aren't everything. Your definition of womanhood is going to change. It's okay to stand up for yourself and don't care about the opinions of others, that really you define who you are. And that it's okay to have periods where you're not always happy and bubbly, and that transition itself is a work in progress. I believe that transition has saved my life, and I do feel that if I did not transition, I would not be here. And so, you know, what I hope that I could pass on to younger folks who are earlier in their transition is to strive, is to persevere, is to look to people who you can find examples in. You know, we have Janet Mock, we have Laverne Cox, we have other folks that we can look up to, but also find folks that are around you that you can look up to. You know, I think it's so important early in transition to be kind to yourself. We don't have to look a certain way. We don't have to act a certain way, you know, to really be able to call it a transition. You will not be in the same place you are in the next 5 years.
Thank you, Kelendria. Okay, Ms. Major, back to you. What advice would you give people that you think they should know in the first year of their transition?
One of the things that they should know is the fact that they can be anybody that they choose to be. They can search and sit down and take the time to see the different types of women. They can be a woman who likes, I don't know, working on a farm, working in mud, working in an office building. They can be anybody that they choose, and they don't have to be, and they're not stuck in a position to whereby they can't change. Something can happen in an instant and change who you want to be and how you present yourself. You can present yourself however you choose and whatever form you see that works.
Beautiful words. Thank you so much. We're just about at the end, and people have been asking, can they follow you on social media? Can they learn more from you? So
yeah, sure. Yeah. They sure can.
Okay. So where do they find you?
House of GG. And then I have a personal page, Miss Major.
I will put it in the chat. It's Nation to Nation Facilitations in terms of email.
Everything is just in my name, Syrus Marcus Ware. So Syrus Marcus Ware at Gmail or at Syrus Marcus Ware on Twitter or on Instagram. I'm prolific on Instagram. That's where you can see me the most. I also have a website with my artwork and stuff that's syrusmarcusware.com.
Ms. Major, we are all greatly indebted to you, not just for today, but for the last 50 years, and hopefully there'll be another 50 years. So, in good health. There's no point in living another 50 years if you're not in good health. So I wish you another 50 years in good health. Thank you all so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye, Dave. Thank you. Take care. Bye.